Good evening. We're very excited today. Today we've got Meghna Pant with us as we're going to discuss her new novel, The Terrible, Horrible, Very Good News. I think that's a tongue twister in itself. And we're going to delve into lots of issues today, the biological clock, fertility, motherhood, societal expectations, and so much more. And what's even more exciting, this is going to be made into a major motion picture, and it's going to be called Badnaam Lado. And if you've read the book, you'll know why it's going to be called that. It's really humorous. It's a very inspiring tale of a small town girl and her fight against the social stigma, and it will resonate with every woman and man. And a lot of you know I had my child very, very late in life, so this book definitely, definitely resonated with me. A bit about Meghna. I know all of you know her. She's an award-winning author. She's a columnist. She's a feminist. And she's a TEDx speaker. Her books have been published to critical acclaim. She has had so many different books. She's got Happy Birthday. She's got One and a Half Wife. She's won the Muse India Young Writer Award. And she's been shortlisted for so many, so many awards. Her latest book, The Trouble with Women, was also by Jagannath in 2016, is also considered a landmark in feminist writing and was described as the best book from Jagannath by Hindu Business Line. She has also won the Found South Asia Short Story Award and the Bharat Nirman Award for her writing. This new book of hers is a very different take. I think it's also new for her. It's new for us also, for her as a writer, because it takes a very humorous and a light approach to address such an important issue that's relevant. And it's a question that's actually on a lot of women's mind without being belligerent or pedantic. So today we're talking about the issue of motherhood, how we want it, when we want it. And I like to just start and say, I love the dedication of the book to women everywhere. You are more than just a walking womb, and a good reminder that we are. So first of all, Meghna, welcome to Sipping Thoughts. We're so glad to have you here.
Lovely to be here. Thank you so much for inviting me. I'm really looking forward to this conversation and also of understanding your journey, because honestly, Sukriti, I think that's so inspiring and women should hear that.
Absolutely. I mean, I think a lot of our guests know that I used a surrogate at 47. And you know what? It's been the best decision I've made. And we'll get more into that. So I've got with us Damini. Damini is a very, very avid reader and the editor of Sipping Thoughts. And we're excited for her to join me.
Yeah. So this was, you know, very interesting conversation when I was told about this book and that we're going to discuss it. And I think me and Sukriti ma'am had a lot of conversation about this, the subject and everything, and it got us really interested. So I want to ask you first thing, Meghna, what inspired you? Was there one specific thing? Was it series of events? Was it over the course of time? What inspired you to write this?
You know, Damini, I had found myself childless and single at the age of 33. And I spent so many years torturing myself and allowing society to kind of shame me for what I was told is my failure. You know, and I had a good career. I'd lived abroad. I'd lived in four different countries. I'd survived an abusive relationship. I'd published books and won awards. But still, I let people tell me things like I wasn't woman enough until I'd had a child. So basically, I was Laddu. So, you know, fortunately for me, I met a man, you know, I got married, and then at the age of 37 and 39, I had two beautiful daughters. And I think I kept thinking ki it was also, you know, for me to get pregnant, my pregnancy, my delivery, all normal, easy pregnancies, touch wood. But because I've been fed this whole narrative that older women have difficulty conceiving, they give birth to children with problems, I'd actually honestly braced myself for complete futility. So nobody was more surprised than I was when, it, you know, I had kids at a later age, and it was very, touch wood, very smooth. And this led me to the question, the very obvious question, ki everything I'd been told about pregnancy and fertility, kya wo jhoot tha? You know, ki jo society, what they feed us, you know, from the time you're born, ki, is it all a lie? So I think we have to first of all understand women's bodies are stronger than we give them credit for. I think that's the first thing. And we need to debunk everything we've been taught about motherhood and marriage and the biological clock. So I think that's why I wrote this book.
That is so fantastic. But one of the things that always strikes me whenever I hear your introduction or I see your profile anywhere, that you say that you are a feminist. So what is a feminist? And you say you identify with Lado also, or Laddu. I'm not sure how we should be pronouncing that because both sound great to me. And she's your main character. Is she also a feminist?
So Laddu is a silent feminist. You know, Tamara, her sister, she's very woke and she's a social media influencer. So she uses all the correct terms. She uses her platform to voice her opinion about equality. Laddu does it quietly. So I always believe that, you know, it's not that being a feminist is being loud. You can go about your ways in a quiet way and still be a feminist. So it's not about going on dharnas and, you know, burning bras and hating men. That is not what feminism is. Feminism is based not even men versus women. It's basically women and men versus patriarchy, because patriarchy has been unjust to both genders. We've spoken so much about women's issues, but patriarchy also puts men in a box, right? A man is always expected to pay the bill. He's always supposed to be strong. Boys don't cry. They're supposed to be the sole earning members of their family. There are a lot of injustices that are done to men also in the name of patriarchy. So feminists are not only fighting for women, they're also fighting for men. So always see it as a movement of equality for both genders. And I think for me, it's not about being loud. It's about being strong. And I think that's what Laddu is. You know, she's not loud. She's not a prototype of a feminist, right? How we imagine them. But Tamara kind of is more. Tamara is more woke and she's like, I will not be broken by the system, but I will break it. So I've presented two very different people, because even in my life, like I talk about feminism on social media platforms or in public, but say my grandmother, she was not even educated. She was illiterate. But she raised four daughters. She became a widow at the age of 35. She had no money. She had no job. But yet she sent them to the best schools in Shimla and then Chandigarh. And she was the reason my mother never entered the kitchen, but always studied. And then she went on to join, you know, the civil services, IRS. She graduated as a gold medalist from Punjab University. She was presented the President's Award. She retired as the Chief Commissioner of Income Tax in Mumbai. And all that is because of my nani. And she didn't even know what the word feminist is, but she was one. So I think I've drawn examples from my real life of what I have seen as strong, powerful women who are like my nani.
Fantastic.
This is very interesting. So, you know, you have already mentioned about the two main characters.
Yeah.
Okay. And we would like to know, do you see yourself in either of them? Like, they're all on both different spectrum right now.
Yeah.
Where do you see yourself between them?
I think I do in some ways. I am like Tamara in many ways, because I think now at least with age, I know my mind. I am able to exercise agency, and I refuse to be shamed for tasks that are very odiously demanded of women, which earlier I could not. You know, I used to find it difficult to stand up for myself when I was younger, but now I have absolutely no problem. And, you know, she may not want things like motherhood and childbirth and cooking and chastity. She doesn't admire those qualities, but she will not disrespect a woman who does want them. So Laddu and she want very different things from life, but they don't disrespect one another's choices. So, you know, that's, I think, something that's for me has been the key takeaway, that if you be a good woman and you be a good feminist, but more importantly and most importantly, be a good human being. So I see myself in Laddu. I see myself in her desires for having a child so badly and being, you know, she's divorced. She's trying to find her way around her biological clock. She's racing against time to have a child that she so desires. At the same time, she's not given up on love. So I was also that person in many ways. But in a way, I'm also Tamara, who, you know, kind of knows her mind. So I think all my characters are kind of slivers that I've borrowed from, you know, real life. These are people I've seen around me and perhaps reflections of myself also and the many, many qualities that I possess.
But that was something that was incredibly beautiful about your book. Not only Laddu and Tamara, but also the other characters, because, you know, when we see the mother or we see Kamini Kavya, I mean, of course, I remember her maybe because of the title. Now, of course, we have a picture of all of these women in our minds. And now this book is going to be made into a major motion picture. Who would you love to see as Laddu, Kamini Kavya, Tamara, you know, some of the main characters that we are associating with?
So the movie has been picked up. We're going to make an announcement pretty shortly. It's a big movie production house. I'm very excited for it. I think things got delayed because of the pandemic and the industry has been very badly affected by it. But I'd love to see Laddu. I think somebody like, I don't know if you all agree, since you've read the book and you've enjoyed it so much. I don't know, you know, somebody like Thapsi Pannu or even Bhumi Padmekar. Right. Even or even Kiara Advani or maybe I know Kriti Sanon and maybe her also. I don't know, for some reason, but Laddu, the name, like I want somebody a little plump.
Imagine her to be a little plump.
I don't like, you know, a real woman. Or Sonakshi Sinha, Parin Chopra, even Sanya Malhotra, who's been doing some phenomenal work. And Tamara, I see, I don't know why, I just see Ananya Pandey. For some reason, she just, I think she'll really capture her very well. But even people like, I think Janvi Kapoor or Disha Patani, Mithila Palkar, Alaya Furniture Wala would be good. Kamini Kavya was my most interesting character because she's got
some
lines that poor character. You know, by the end, everybody's like, Kamini hai. So I would love to see Nusrat Bharucha. I feel like she, you know, because Kavya is so beautiful. But at the same time, you know, her claws are out. And I think that character would be very interesting. Yeah, exactly. It should be very interestingly played by, say, Nusrat Bharucha, even Shraddha Kapoor, for that matter. I think she'll be able to capture her very well. Or Vani Kapoor, Kriti Kulari. I think these actors would bring a lot of character to Kavya. Fortin, I don't know if you guys have seen The White Tiger, but there's Adarsh Gaurav. I don't know. I can't imagine anyone else except Adarsh Gaurav playing Fortin. And Sandeep Oberoi, I mean, I want to cast Hrithik Roshan in every movie because he's so fabulous looking. But I think even Ayushmann Khurana, it'll be more like a guest appearance because, you know, it's a smaller role, but it's a meaty role. So even just some very good looking actor like Tiger Shroff or even Vicky Kaushal or just somebody like that. I don't know. What are your thoughts? What did you maybe?
Oh, you're bang on, especially for like Laddu, right?
For Laddu, right?
A little bit plumper because you do also say she doesn't have the perfect figure. So, you know, yeah, she's like the everyday girl that you associate with.
Absolutely. Because that's a big characteristic of hers in the book, at least, that, you know, she's a typical woman. I think I've not met a single woman who's not told me that, Meghna, I need to lose 5 kilos. I wish women were taught to love their bodies, but unfortunately, even the, you know, the one of the best figure will say, I need to lose 5 kilos. So I think Laddu's kind of that, symbolizes that.
And you know, that's the beauty of all the characters, that no matter how much we judge them or anything, they all look very real. You can read them and you can see these people around you. You cannot deny that these are all real characters that are around you in some way or the other. So,
exactly.
Talking about the movie and the book and everything. So, how about we would like if you can read your favorite passage from the book?
Sure, I'd love to. I actually like the scene where she, where they're kind of just sitting on the terrace. And, you know, in the first chapter itself, and she tells her, you know, you can have my eggs. So, I think I like that particular you know, where Laddu's trying to get pregnant without getting married with a boyfriend, then trick him into marrying her because she says, India mein toh, you know, pregnancy means marriage. So I think that I really liked that, you know, Laddu's come home with her mother. And I think that's the passage I can read when she goes up to the terrace to check on Tamara. So Laddu looks around to check if anyone's watching. She walks over to a cot where Mirchi is laid out for drying, unzips the gadda and takes out a pregnancy stick. Suddenly, she hears a sound behind her. Oh no, has she been caught? Laddu turns around in shock. Phew, it's only Tamara, young, thin, and beautiful, dressed up in shorts and a ganji. Jai Bholinath, Laddu tells Tamara. I thought it was that Kamini Kavya. Kavya is a bitchy neighbor who's always interfering in the sisters' private lives. Laddu pats Tamara's head affectionately and hands her the plate of eggs. Here are your banned goods, she says. One day somebody will catch you, Tammy. Who cares, Deeds? The 28-year-old Tamara says, shrugging her shoulders. She takes a bite of the egg. You know I only give tension. I never take tension. Laddu grins at Tamara. She takes a pregnancy stick and sneaks into the small bathroom on their terrace. She sits down on the pot and waits eagerly. The stick still shows only one line. So bloody unfair, the 34-year-old grumbles. How come even Billy can get pregnant and I can't? Billy's their cat. The dog. Laddu leaves the stick on the sink and comes out of the bathroom. She finds Tamara sprawled on the mirchi ka gadda, making a video of herself smoking a joint. Tammy, I told you not to hide your ganja next to my pregnancy sticks. Maybe that's the reason I'm not getting pregnant, she scolds her sister. Don't be so extra, Deeds, Tamara says, using her usual millennial slang. And shh, I'm making Rishikesh's best Insta video. Hot Yogini does ganja. Guaranteed 10,000 views. You millennials, Laddu says, you're the world's only generation that makes doing nothing look like something. You know you're a millennial too, right, Didi? I know, but I feel like a boomer, Tammy. Laddu plops down next to Tamara. Tamara stops recording a video and looks at her sister concerned. What happened, Deeds? Nothing, Tammy. I'm still not pregnant, Laddu whispers. You're also not, Tammy says, and makes a wedding shanai sound. Ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta don't use a condom. I was ovulating that day. I didn't make sure he ate bananas before. So, you know, his sperm count increased. Still, nothing. Ovulate? Tamara asked her loudly. Shh. Kamini Kave might be listening to us, Laddu says. No one is there, fortunately. And then Laddu adds, ovulation is the only time that a woman can get pregnant, 2 weeks after her periods. You've lost it, Deeds. Are you even speaking English? Tamara says, looking seriously at Laddu. Look, I'm woke and all, and I know it's 2021. But are you sure you know what you're doing? What if you actually get pregnant? Laddu looks at Tamara, confused. That is the plan. The plan is to get knocked up and guilt Ricky into proposing. Of course, we are Indian. Pregnancy means marriage. 1 second. So if he proposes, you'll actually, for reals, marry Ricky. Of course, yes, Laddu says, looking at her sister like she's calling the sun yellow. But what about Mr. Right? Forget Mr. Right. I need Mr. Right now. That's a small passage from the book. And as you can see, it's mostly dialogues and, you know, it's just the opening chapter of the book where you see Tamara and Laddu's interaction and Laddu's almost like desperation to get pregnant, you know, by whatever means possible.
But this is a very different book. So how difficult was it for you to write a comedic novel, something that's more on the lighter side, something that's more humorous?
You know, I have to confess something. This was actually one of the easiest books that I've written, Sukriti. So my books actually usually take me almost, I think, years to put together. But because I think the story or the backdrop of the story was so close to my heart, it was something I feel like I've gone through. I see so many women around me going through. It was gestating in my mind for so long that, so Siddharth Jain of The Story Inc. had picked up the concept of this book last year. He said he loved the concept of a woman using a donor without being married in a small town. You know, because I think in big cities like Mumbai and Delhi, where we guys live, we will not be shocked by anything, right? But in smaller towns, I think they have a very different emotional bandwidth where I think they dig deeper into their feelings, you know, whether it's love or shock or whatever else it is. And I think that's why I set it in a place like Rishikesh, where it's a big deal to do something so unconventional. And that too, for someone like Laddu's personality, she's not one of your Tamaras, right? She's a soft-spoken, quiet, gentle soul. These characters have just kind of come to me very easily because I identified so much with them. 410, for example, is a nickname I borrowed from a childhood friend. His name is Uday, but we all call him 410. So, you know, those names, that name was at the back of my mind. Amara is my daughter's name and also the protagonist of my first novel, One and a Half Wife. So I'd written it 12 years ago and I said, if I have a daughter, and I was convinced I'm going to have a daughter one at some point in my life, I ended up being blessed with two, fortunately. I said, I'll name my daughter Amara, like literally 12 years ago. So I always name my protagonist in all my novels Amara. It's just like one of my good luck things. So Amara, Tamara. So I think these characters had just come to me and where I think mothers and daughters, the relationships they have, you know, like if our parents support us in any decision we make, we can fight the whole universe. But if our parents are not with us in our journey, then we're very weak. So that's why the opposition had to come from either of her parents. And I thought the mother equation would be very interesting. You know, that a woman is only not understanding what another woman's deep desire to have a child is. So I think that's where all these characters came in. But I have never written a book so fast. I wrote it just last year during the pandemic. I had a small, my baby's now a year old. I literally had a nursing baby and a toddler at home. We were all locked up. And I just wrote it, you know, to throw my COVID life into sharp relief because I needed humor at that time to cope. So I wrote it as a comedy, which I think was a good thing in hindsight because I think it's working well right now.
No, it was fantastic. It's really a nice light read because you're right. Even in this time, I think it's very hard for us to read very serious material or very depressing.
Yeah. It's difficult to write also serious stuff. I've written my next novel, Boys Don't Cry, which is based a very deeply personal novel on domestic violence. And I kind of finished writing it just before the pandemic started. So I'm glad I got it out of the way because I think right now all of us need some sense of relief, you know. So writing very heavy books or reading them, it's a little bit difficult.
And you know, it's an amazing way that you have woven such a serious and important subject in such a simple writing style that it can get through to anyone. That's one of the things, you know, that I really like. And especially the bond between the two sisters. You mentioned about mother and daughters and all their bonds. But I think that, you know, the bond between the two sisters was something, you know, I'm very close to my sister. Maybe that's why I relate to that. And it's interesting not seeing something like this. If this comes on screen, I would love to see that scene that you just, read.
Yeah.
How that plays out.
Thank you, Damini. So glad.
So you're talking about, you know, you mentioned about, you know, how this idea of being an unwed mother, especially in small towns and everything. So what made you pick up this particular backdrop? Because it's not just unwed mother, it's an unwed mother going for donor sperm and all that. So why did you choose it? Wouldn't it have been easier? Why this particular small city background?
So small cities, I've explained, because, you know, I think people there, like I said, they dig deeper into their emotions. They also have the time and the bandwidth. But the reason I selected this particular topic is because I want women to know that, you know, my body, my rules, or my body, my choice applies to each and every one of them. So I don't think anyone should tell women if they should have children, first of all. It's totally your choice when they should have them. Ki matlab aap 25 ya 30 ki umar mein karna hi hai. You know, that whole pressure that is put on women and the biological clock. So please look around you. People like Sukriti and me have had children much later. And there's so many means of having children now. And I've always said that motherhood is not about biology. It's about emotions. It doesn't matter from where you get the child, if it's biological, or if you adopted, or you use surrogacy or IVF or jo bhi hai. It's all about the emotions, because, you know, that's what the whole parenting journey is all about. So don't let people tell you when to have a child, if you should have a child, how you should have a child, and what to do after you have a child. So that was the whole main message of the book, because I feel like society is opinionated about everything that a woman does with her body, you know, from the way we dress up to the way we occupy public spaces to our biological clock. But when it comes to serious issues that have to do with, you know, female bodies like rape and domestic violence, infanticide, that time society will assume a wide distance. And I think that hypocrisy needs to end. You can't have it both ways. So don't listen to society when it tells you what to do with your body, because when you actually need help, that same society is not there. So forget that hypocrisy. It's your body, your choice. And I think that's the main message of the book.
I really like that. Do you think the social stigma will break? Because this biological clock that's constantly ticking is still a lot of pressure, whether you're in a metro, not in a metro. And today we would say that Laddu is very young. 34 is actually very, very young, as we see women. And even in your book at 50, you know, that are getting pregnant. We've just seen welcome the baby. Do you think that the social stigma will break, or what will it take to break it?
Will it take? Sorry, your voice dropped.
What will it take to break it?
I think women have to start acting in individual capacity. Because, you know, when individuals change, then I think families change, then society starts changing, and then nations change. So I think we need to start, like I said before, you know, we started this discussion by talking about feminism. It's not about, you know, big loud statements. Just change your daily life. Like simple things like, if you're sitting at the dining table, sit with your brothers and your husbands and your fathers. You don't have to serve them. You don't have to pick up their plate. They can pick up their own plate and take it to the kitchen. And also don't be gatekeepers if they're trying to help out. So I talk about men's role in this, but also women have a role to play equally. That don't be gatekeepers to men helping you out. So now that I'm a mother, I've seen that many of my friends will be like, okay, don't let your husband change the diaper. He's taking so long to do it. I'm giving you a very small example. But if I stop my husband because he's going to take, you know, 1 minute longer than I will, then I can't at the same time cry ki he's not helping me out for the children. So you can't, again, you can't have it both ways for both genders. So I think that's what, again, the whole message is that start with individual change. And, you know, it doesn't matter how much opposition you get. Like Laddu is a very soft-spoken girl, but she gets so much grit inside her when she decides, ki, I am going to do this. No matter what happens, take charge of your life in the same way. That no matter what impediments come your way, you will do what you are set out to do. And let no one stop you, including your parents, even though you trust them implicitly. And trust me, you'll find a lot of supporters along the way. Like she finds it in her best friend. She finds it in unexpected places. Like even Kamini Kavya comes around. Her father changes, you know, his expression towards her after a while. So I think, and once she has the baby, then suddenly everybody's gathering for, you know, and supporting her. So if you take charge of your life, you will find so many people to egg you on. So, but you have to first own it.
I so true. Could not resonate that much here because I do agree. When we were also thinking about the same, we were like, we're such older parents, constantly playing on our mind. But once we took the plunge, the support actually was immense. You're so right. I think it's in our mind a lot of it.
It's always in our mind. The impediment is always, the fear is always in our mind. It's not out there as much. And once you cross that fear, then, you know, I left a very high-paying corporate job to become a writer. And at least book writing doesn't pay. So I had to take on a lot of other jobs like freelance journalism. And I hosted podcasts and I hosted digital shows. I did a lot of events. But at no point did I let anyone tell me, ki, okay, you're not getting a regular paycheck. Aren't you scared for your future? Because I took ownership of my decision. I said, ab galti hai toh meri galti hai, success ho toh mera success hai. You know, now nobody can tell me otherwise. So I think that almost, you know, doggedness, that stubbornness has to come in, that focus has to come in. And we all have to, again, own our lives and you'll just enjoy the ride after that.
So I think we can change my body, my rules to my life, my rules. And
absolutely, Damini, absolutely.
Yeah. So one thing really interesting, you touched upon your, you spoke a bit about your next one, Boys Don't Cry, which, you know, where you touch upon breaking down gender stereotypes and also about domestic violence and all. Please tell us a little bit about more about that and what is the process going on that front?
So this was a very, very difficult book for me to write because it's inspired from my own experiences. I was a victim of domestic abuse. And despite all my education, despite all my worldliness, you know, people always saw me as a very independent, strong girl. It was in my 20s, but I still wasn't able to speak out against my perpetrator. I kept it hidden from even my bestest friend till things got very heated. Like I had become almost suicidal. So, you know, that's the time I started talking about it publicly. But later on, once I got out of it, it was a very, very long and arduous journey. It took me 5 years I was in that abusive relationship. Then it took me time to get out. So it was 7 years of my life had just gone in that. And then the recovery from it. So I think I spent a decade just being victimized and then moving my narrative from being the victim to being the survivor to being a cheerleader of, you know, of women's rights. That I think because I hadn't spoken up for myself, it's led me to question why are educated, modern, independent women not speaking up for themselves? Why have we not been taught to raise our voice? And that's what made me a feminist. So it also made me a writer because I realized that life is very short and anything can happen to you. So, you know, you have to follow your passion. So in a way, that terrible experience has made me who I am today. So I'm very thankful for it in a way. It was very painful when it was happening, but it has made me a very, and I've met a wonderful man. I'm married to a really, really gentle, sweet person. I'm very happy. And I think there is a rainbow at the end of that. So, you know, there is a happy ending. And I never used to believe in happy endings, but now I do. Thanks to my husband primarily. He'll be very happy to hear this, by the way. But, so I think because I wasn't able to speak up for myself, I really want women to be able to, that, you know, learn from my example, don't make my mistakes. And there is a light at the end of the tunnel, however dark it may seem.
That takes a lot of strength, especially when you have to send down your own personal story. And I think, thank you for doing that. Because when we hear the stories of other women, I think it gives us also the courage to say, okay, I'm not alone. And I too can see maybe that rainbow at the end of the tunnel. So thank you for that, because I think it really helps a lot of us out there. Because, you know, as we read and as we listen to other people, we go into a different world. But one of the questions I think that always everyone asks us, even though you say being an author doesn't pay, everybody wants to be published. And I know you work on this? And I have to ask this question because that is a latent desire in so many people. How does one get published and how terribly hard is it?
So this is my book, How to Get Published in India. And it has earned me a lot of good karma because I think I started off my journey as a writer without any mentors, without any godfathers. And it was very difficult for me to understand. You know, I had an economics and statistics undergrad degree, then an MBA in finance. I'd worked in corporate finance. So, you know, I wasn't from this field at all. So I had to teach myself everything about publishing, from how to write a book, then how to publish a book, and then how to market a book. And I honestly, I didn't know anything, even with my first two books. It was a very steep learning curve. And on top of that, there are no guidebooks in India. And I've never understood that. So Shobha Day had launched this book at the Jaipur Lit Fest. And she shared a very interesting thing that she said, authors don't want to share their secrets. You know, that, but I believe that knowledge, if you share it, then it grows. You know, your own knowledge, from writing this book, I also, my knowledge of the industry grew so much. So the book breaks it up into how to write a book. I've given a lot of tips and how to publish a book, you know, including everything you need to know about publishers and that, you know, that very opaque, intimidating world of publishing, and then how to market a book. And I've drawn examples from people like Chetan Bhagat and Amish Tripathi, who've been brilliant at marketing their books. And on top of that, the last section of the book are essays from Jeffrey Archer, Twinkle Khanna, Shobha Day, who else? Durjoy Datta, Ravi Subramaniam, Rashmi Bansal, Meena Kandasamy, Preeti Shenoy. All of them have, on different aspects of publishing, they've written essays. So I think all in all, I think anything you need to know about how to write, sell a book and how to publish a book is in this book. And it's helped a lot of people. I've been getting so many beautiful messages for the last 2 years since this book has come out. And I think it's earned me a lot of good karma. So I think do yourself a favor. If you want to get published, just pick up this book, not because I've written it. It will save you just a lot of time and struggle. So just pick it up, spend that $200-$300. It'll save you way, way more, thousands and thousands of rupees more will save you. And because there's nothing like else out there in the market like this, at least in India, I think it's a good go-to guide. And I'm not saying this because I've written it, just because I've seen
it. No, it was my next pickup book because I have also been thinking the same question. How do I get published?
So one last question we would like to know. What are you reading right now? What are your go-to books and what are you reading right?
So I am obsessed with Alice Munro, who is a Canadian short story writer. And she writes only short stories. And I love that she's bucked the trend because short stories don't sell. So anybody who's in publishing knows that. But she has stuck to her gun and she said, "Miss, I'll only write short stories." And her books are brilliant. And she won the Nobel Prize in Literature a couple of years back. And I was like, she's probably one of the only short story writers in the world to have done that. So I really admire her. And Chimamanda Adichie also, she's a Nigerian writer. She's also a feminist. So We Should All Be Feminists is a book of hers that you must read. It's a very, very thin volume. That thing around your neck. She's written a lot of books. So these are my go-to books, which I read all the time. And a lot of Indian authors also, of course, I keep reading. Rohinthan Mistry, Arvind Adigar, my classic, you know, go-tos. But even contemporary authors, like I love Manu Joseph's work. There's so many others, Janice Perriott, who else? There's so many authors out there who are doing very, very interesting work. Dipti Kapoor has written a lovely book called A Bad Character that I think everyone should read. Then K.R. Meera, her book Hangwoman is brilliant. Benjamin has written lovely books. Perumal Murugan. So all these people are, you know, authors that I think are not as mainstream as they should be, but they've written brilliant, brilliant books. And I think everybody in India should pick up their books and, you know, please stop reading only Chetan Bhagat. It is it is a disservice to our nation, which has such a rich history of storytelling. Please expand your list and, you know, read interesting authors. There are lots of them out there.
Now, Meghna, the last one. Any last words you'd like to leave us with as we end and wrap up our exciting session for today? So much knowledge and so many, I think, glimpses that we got of you.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Sukriti. Thank you so much for having me here. This was such an interesting discussion.
Good night. And hopefully we'll see you all next week. We have sessions coming up every Monday. And I love speaking to Meghna, learned so much about her. And like we said, please pick it up. It's a light, easy read. I think I finished it in 2-3 hours. How long did it take you, Damini?
sorry. Yeah, so I think it took me barely one night I was able to get through it. It was so funny because I didn't want to put it down without reading it into it.
Thank you so much. Very kind of you. Thank you, Damini. Thank you, Sukhiti. It was so lovely chatting with both of you. And guys, pick up the book. It's a fun, light read. Perfect for the pandemic, I think.
So good night, everyone, and see you soon.